And we should be getting ready to start in just a few minutes. We've had a bit of technical problems, but no webinar without problems. So we're ready to see you in a very short time. And we're really ready to start now. It's really nice to see where you guys are from. So please check the chat and tell me where you're from and let me know if you can hear me and if you're ready. And I think we are live now. Welcome. I think you're all out there to our new studio here on the webinar scene here in our new office in Aarhus, Denmark. I'm not just me here in the office. In fact, I'm a whole team of great guys that I normally share these premises with. And I've decided that tonight I want to surprise them and actually show them to you. So with a little help from the screen, I will allow you to see what happens on the back of the studio. Oh, who's there? Hey guys. That looked interesting. Okay, great. I think we're about here. So I can't actually, there's someone from Brisbane, Australia, Sweden, Aarhus, Denmark, Norway, Slovenia, Finland, Northern Norway. Excellent. It's really good to see you all. Okay, tonight's webinar is with Nanna. Nanna is an underwater photographer doing free diving, and I've been looking forward to get her in the studio. But before that, allow me to present or introduce myself. My name is Lars. I own the FOTOGRAFIT company that sells underwater housings and stuff for particularly the Nordic region, but also a large part of the European area. It's been an exciting couple of winter months. I haven't been this active on the webinars and making videos on my YouTube channel simply because I've been busy. One of the things is I've been to China and doing a service course with Nauticam, and I'm really proud to say that we're now a distributor here in the Nordic region. And we're also now to Nauticam service facility, which makes us really proud and really opportunistic about the upcoming year and helping all you guys out there with their new kit. And I have decided that I want to present Christopher. Hey, Christopher, come on over. Leave the beer.
Leave the beer.
Christopher's a young guy that does all my service. He's 20 years old. Hey, Christopher.
Hi, everyone.
You have to look up there. Oh, okay. He is my service guy. And what I haven't told many people is that Christopher has been appointed a very interesting or very fantastic title. Christopher is the first Nauticam Young Ambassador, Talent Ambassador. And that's actually, it's never happened before that a young person has been taken into Nauticam as an ambassador, a young talent ambassador. And I'm extremely proud that it's been Christopher. He's a good guy. He's an excellent diver. He's a really, really good upcoming photographer. He knows everything there is to know about the housings. In fact, they were so impressed with him down at the factory in China that they want him to come back. So that's a bit of a problem for me. Christoph, I'm really happy that you're here, and thanks for taking care of the housings.
Yeah, you're welcome.
Yeah, sure. So, but thanks. So,
okay,
leave us again. Bye, bye, Christopher. Other than that, I'm happy to say that this spring is going to be exciting on the webinar front. This year, particularly, is going to be interesting on the education front. But about webinars, I'm hoping to do at least two more. These next spring month, in 1 month time, there's going to be a webinar with a British person that I'm looking forward to invite over here to Aarhus to actually join me in the webinar. But that's enough for me and the company for now. Let's invite the lady that it all that it's all about. Nanna, please come on in here.
Thank you.
Come on here. I'm not going to applaud you. Let me just do this. Hello, hello. And it's very formal because we haven't seen each other all afternoon.
We haven't been spending the afternoon together at all.
No. So here we are. And
hello, everybody.
Can we see some hellos from...
can you hear and see us?
I hope they can hear us. I would have been all for nothing.
Obviously.
Nanna is originally born here in Aarhus, but she's actually traveling around the world most of the time. She's a picture journalist, a photojournalist. Mm-hmm. She has an education from the Danish School of Journalism and Media. Exactly. In fact, it's the same school that I'm originally graduated from because they merged together. I'm from the graphic industry, but she's from the journalism industry now. And Nanna, you have. When did you get your degree? Many years ago.
I finished in 2007. Yeah, so it's. Okay. I have almost 10 years of.
Amazing.
Anniversary. Yeah. Oh, wow, I'm getting old.
Me too. And what Nanna does for a living is to take pictures for the media world, large magazines, large newspapers, NGOs. She's traveling around the world all the time, but try to stay as much as she can near the water. Mm-hmm. With a housing, with a camera, and she wants to get a lot more into the underwater picture side of things. But you've been taking pictures for a long time now, haven't you?
Yeah.
Why don't you tell us a little bit about your background as a photographer?
Yeah.
not as an underwater photographer, but
okay. My I'm educated. First of the time, I'm educated in art history, and I was not really academic at all. So I had a friend of mine, and he asked me one day, being like, why don't you become a photojournalist? You don't know how to take pictures, but you can write and you have a good eye, because I'm drawing a lot as well. And then he asked me, and then in 5 minutes, I just knew I had to become a photographer. And it took me 2 years of really hard work, and then I got accepted into the Danish School of Journalism.
Yeah, because they just don't take anyone in there, right? It's quite hard to get in
there. It's quite hard. We are a team of 8 to 10 people every half year. Yeah.
Yeah.
So it's
in all of Denmark.
Yeah.
Okay.
And then I graduated. I always been swimming a lot. I've been freediving. No, sorry. I was freediving when I was younger, actually, and I did surf life saving.
Snorkeling, perhaps.
Snorkeling. I was a lifeguard and did competitive swimming for many years.
All right.
Yeah. But when I started taking pictures, it was kind of, I really focused all my energy in there.
Yeah.
So when I finished again, my brother invited me to go to Egypt with him. I was like, I don't know if I want to go to Egypt. You know, you hear all the stories about the resorts and about the bad stomachs and stuff. But then he took me to Dahab. And from that moment, I started doing underwater photography.
Yeah. Okay.
So I was really hooked on it. And it kind of goes really well with my other work. So I can kind of, being in the water a little bit and just kind of some of the other stuff I do is pretty hard, and then I can use the water as a kind of coming back to myself, grounding myself.
You do go around the world and take pictures in some of all the hot spots around the world and see pretty nasty stuff, right?
Yeah.
We're going to see a lot of pictures tonight from Nanna, and hopefully you guys are ready to ask questions in the end as well. Let me just tell you that Nanna has decided to donate a picture that she took. It's one of my favorites. I constantly talk about it when I talk to her, and she said, "Listen, If you guys who sees this wanna have a copy for your desktop, mm-hmm. for the computer, we would be really happy to send it out. So if you stay tuned, you will be getting this image by the end of the presentation. But let me see here. I have a. I'm gonna be running all the pictures on this other screen. That's why I'm looking over here. It's not because I'm looking at someone else.
So we decided to start with some of the pictures I'm shooting that has absolutely nothing to do with water.
Yeah.
Just to show you what I'm doing.
Yeah.
So these are a little bit older pictures. I don't know if you want to say something.
No, I don't know the pictures, but I'm okay. Just looking forward to see them.
Okay. So I shot the Egyptian revolution in 2011, 2010. Hmm. And yeah, that was a really big work for me. It kind of did a lot for me in my career because I just went there and then suddenly I was there in the middle of everything. And it really, really started something big for me in the kind of little bit stronger photography. Normally you do portraits and you do normal daily reportage, but this one was really, really big for me. These are on the barricades. And during some of the days, there were big clashes between people.
Let me start some of these pictures. Let me see if I can figure this out. Here yeah. It comes.
This one,
yeah. It's one of the first one. What do we see?
The protesters against the President Mubarak, and they were occupying the Tahrir Square for like 3 weeks, and I was there basically all 3 weeks. And one of the days I got into really big fights with the pro-Mubarak people. So there was a lot of injuries and people were being killed. And these are, they're covering themselves from, they're from with stones and they're covering themselves.
Hmm. So, yeah. Let me see if I can find the next one.
Yeah.
No. This one? No. Sorry, guys. Maybe I have to do this. There we go.
So they were occupying the military vehicles as well, and just making sure they wouldn't move the military because the military was in the first period of time they were not sure whether they were supporting or against the revolution.
Hmm.
So these are occupations.
I'm just going to scroll through them here.
And yeah, so I wanted to show that all the women also were there, that everybody was in the street and really showing their opinion.
Yeah.
I've been living in Sinai for quite a while. It's in Egypt. It's a little peninsula of Egypt. And I've been living there for quite a while, mostly diving, but then every year there is like a camel race up in the hills, and we were up there. Super nice. Really interesting. They run for 30 kilometers through the desert. Yeah, and small guys on camels. This is the winner.
So the kids were on the camels.
Yeah. Excellent. They have to be lighter, the lighter the possible.
Yeah.
This is from Central African Republic. I just came back. I was there in October. This is a girl. She's about to have a cesarean. I was working for an NGO there with the maternity healthcare and maternity, like delivering kids, and also this woman, Lydia, she's in birth.
Okay.
Yeah. And these are other women. This is just a reportage picture. And this is from Haiti in the earthquake in 2009.
Yeah.
So there's a little bit of those.
Yeah.
Yeah. Refugee camp or...
massive.
Yeah, so
interesting. Okay, thanks for I have to do this.
Okay,
you are actually traveling around to all the hotspots of the world, mm-hmm. and seeing all these things. So what you said before is that you use the free diving to sort of get back into organization back in your
mind, and to kind of balance myself.
Mm-hmm.
Because sometimes when you're out there, it can be very tough to see and to be a part of and to experience. And then for me, being in the water is always kind of grounding me.
Yeah.
I leave the surface, and underneath the surface, I don't bring anything.
Mm.
You have to have an empty mind. Mm. So you dissolve yourself into the ocean. And
you do a bit of
healing.
Yoga as well, don't you?
Yes, I do a lot of yoga. It's kind of important to be, if you want to free dive deep, you need to be flexible.
Yeah.
And also in yoga is really grounding. It's really focusing on your breath, focusing on yourself and your inner sensations.
Yeah.
So in that sense, yoga and freediving is very,
yeah,
has a lot in common.
There's a few guys in this office doing a bit of yoga and freediving as well.
Yeah.
Like Steve.
Yeah.
Yeah. Right. Okay.
It's a good combination.
Yeah. I'm sure it is.
Yeah.
I'm sure it is. It's not really me.
No.
Okay, listen, there's a lot of guys out there who are into underwater photography, mm-hmm. who probably liked your pictures, but are really eager to start talking about underwater photography.
Let's
as such.
Start.
I am trying to provoke you guys out there a little bit to maybe expand your picture view. And that's why I brought Nanna in to sort of, because she's doing so much different stuff, right? And she doesn't do much, you don't care much about techniques, you don't care much about actually external lighting. You do dive, scuba dive occasionally, right?
I am a scuba diver, but I prefer, if I can, I prefer to do it free diving.
Yeah. Okay. So Nanna often go out and actually do jobs, competitions and other things where she has to do use her camera underwater. And so you're actually, if you need to do a job scuba diving, you'll be doing that.
Yeah. I'm not kind of a saint on saying I only want a free dive. Okay. For me, it's more like how can I get the closest to one I want to shoot in with media.
Yeah.
For me, it's more about being in the water.
See, one of the things that I'd like you to talk about is the ethics of pictures, because when it apparently you go out and do stuff that is, you know, you sell your pictures to magazines, and if you don't make proper pictures, they won't buy them. So where do you think the limit goes between what you've just done here? We need to get into the underwater photography, because you want to do a lot more of that. You do actually make money from doing underwater photography, but that's not your plan.
Yeah. I try.
You want to go that route particularly. Yeah. And because we haven't seen any pictures from underwater yet, so maybe it's a little bit different, difficult topic, but the ethics of doing a picture. How often how do you see upon the picture? Do you do a lot of Photoshop on your pictures?
Some people might say that I do a lot, because sometimes if any of you have been working with the underwater files, you know, they're very blue. So in the sense of doing a contrast, and I take out a lot of saturation sometimes, because the blue can be super overwhelming for me.
Hmm.
You'll see later that my pictures is kind of subtle in the colors as well. But like manipulating, it's just a no-go for me. You know, I never take anything out or add anything. If I really try to be as truthful to the moment as it is,
mm-hmm.
Because it's the feeling I want to give to people. And this, I want to capture the moment that is in front of me.
One of my, that's not my, the favorite, but one of my, my favorites of your pictures are this one that we're about to see, and I think it explains a lot about
see it in this size, because for me I'm always kind of traveling with a little computer, so
small
all
laptop.
My yeah
so you're saying that my 228 inch size screens here are
they fit really well into a backpack.
I'm sure they would. You can borrow one at least.
Thank you.
See, what do you think of a picture? When I see a picture like this, I'm thinking about the contrast between the free diver and the scuba diver, because obviously there's a lot of scuba divers down there.
You can right? The scuba divers are very present here.
Yes.
In the sense of this is traces from scuba divers.
Yeah. So, were you free diving here?
I was training in the Blue Hole in Egypt, and I was shooting some other people diving, and suddenly I saw her hanging there. And for me, she's out of space, and I didn't talk to her.
No.
Actually, to be honest, I have no idea who she is.
Okay.
She was just hanging there, and if you see really closely, there is a line that she's hanging on to, but it's kind of, there is.
No. Let's see if I can zoom into the picture. Different button.
But she was hanging there, and for me, there is something in between this being in space, being free, being, you know, letting yourself go into this something that's much bigger.
Okay. Oh, there we go. Oh, I see the line now.
Yeah, there is a line in my hand. You can see
see what ISO did you use when you use a picture like this? People would say, "Oh no, it's not good," because you can see the the grains.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, for me, I like, you know, I don't mind.
No.
As long as the picture is expressing an emotion, you know, if you talk to me about techniques and everything, you know, I would be like, I don't know. I don't know so much about techniques. I know what I need to know. Mm. And then I leave it behind and I go and I have the experience of being underwater and to get to know my camera. So it's a kind of a extended part of myself.
Yeah.
And I can capture what I want, but I don't know so much about these things. And for me, I don't mind the mistakes there is. If you're, for instance, diving pictures where everything is super well exposed and everything, for me, this is not what I want to do. I want to impose a feeling in people. I want to kind of the expression of the picture, the ambience.
Mm. I guess that's what I'm trying to get you to say, because
something.
No. What I want you to try and express, at least, because out there is a lot of people who do underwater photography. They're not from the school of photography. They're not from a society of photography. They've just been maybe keen divers, took up photography because they really like to get some images out of the water of what they took pictures of. And for me, the people that I talk to every day, they talk a lot about, is the picture well exposed? Is it well lit?
Yeah.
Is it sharp? How's the corners? Oh no, we can't use this. The corners are blurry. But very, very rarely I talk to people that they call me and they need a camera that just expresses a feeling.
Mm-hmm.
So you're saying that you go out there and you want to find the feeling?
I want to find the feeling, the emotion. I want to kind of try to tell people who is not free diving yourself into the ocean.
Hmm.
I want to kind of try to tell them, how does it feel to be there?
Yeah.
It's not a struggle to be underwater. Even you don't have air. You can relax, you can hang out, you can just let yourself go. And this is what I want to try to impress when I do express when I do a picture like this.
Mm.
This feeling of a freedom, of weightlessness.
Yeah. Okay.
So.
I think we have a. Okay, it was a technical issue that Sovis wanted to tell us about. Okay, but I hope you're all out good out there. Cheers, people! I hope you're having fun and the coffee is hot and sweet. It's hot in here. Hmm. Okay, but you do actually take other than freediving pictures. I had to persuade you a little bit, but you found a few pictures that were macro pictures, and you said, "Oh, sure, I do macro pictures." And you came out with these, and I was
They're really macro, no? Yeah,
these are macro pictures. Hmm.
For me, they're really close.
Yeah, so let's have a look at your macro.
My favorite, the frogfish.
Yeah, where do you take this picture?
I shot it in Limbe in Indonesia during a night dive. Yeah. We were actually going for mandarin fish because I wanted to see them, and my partner wanted to see them.
Yeah.
So we were going, and then I changed the lens into the camera, which is absolutely, you know, it's super wrong lens probably, but I don't know, I just wanted to be closer.
Not many people do macro pictures with a wide angle lens.
No, but you know. You have to try.
Have more light with them, but you had a spotlight, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. A lot of people have to start with their equipment, they start with a basic camera and a lens, and light often comes afterwards, and they use a dive torch.
Mm.
And you did that here?
Yeah. If that's what you say, I did.
Okay. I like this picture, and again, I think you can get creative situations out of almost anything. What were you doing in Indonesia at the time?
I just came back from Africa shooting this story with the mothers, and I needed to get out and get away, so I went for Indonesia.
Let me assume this one a little bit. They are slightly, the resolution is not so high, but I'm sure you can see this. I quite like this one. You know, a lot of people would say, they would say, this is not a really macro picture. And then they would say, this is a wrong picture because you can't see the eyes.
Yeah, but that's the thing about the pufferfish.
Yeah.
Is that it can, some of them can actually move its eyes, you know, independently.
Yeah.
Yeah, super amazing. It was kind of, yeah, it was moving it back and forward.
But, you know, I wouldn't mind having a large imprint of this here in my office because it makes me happy every time I see this fish, pufferfish. And it's nice to know that you are also doing a bit of macro photography. Yeah. when you
macro,
are,
as you
macro,
say.
That's macro. Yeah. We need to teach you real macro at some point.
Yeah.
I think there was maybe one more. It doesn't really matter. But
no, I think you did them all.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
So, I think we can conclude that you have your own style, or at least you're trying to.
I'm really trying to kind of be truthful to the way I live the world and to be inspired by other people, which is very important, but still kind of saying, okay, this is the way I see the world.
Mm.
I'm not going to try to be as anybody but Nanna.
Hmm.
And
what do you think, how have you found your own style now?
Yes, I think so. Yeah, I'm finding my own style, Nanna 2016-17.
Yeah.
And I might change at some point. Okay. I might want to do something else, but right now I feel super comfortable. I bought the I bought my Nauticam with you.
Did you really?
Yeah, really. That's 1.5 years ago.
Yeah.
Yeah. And since then, I've been moving quite a lot with the underwater. And it's been such a treat. Going almost every day. I was living in Egypt for half a year.
Yeah.
And almost going every day with the camera. Getting to know it, getting to know the buttons, which is really crucial when you go.
But when you're saying about the style and finding your own style, I'm pretty sure there's some underwater photographers out there who has never, ever thought about what was their style. And for many photographers who's not making a living out of taking a picture, I'm a commercial photographer, a studio photographer originally, and I knew the different studios in town, and I knew this guy over here, he does these kind of pictures, and I'm pretty sure all the commercial agencies, they knew as well that if you want to have this kind of picture, you go to this guy, and if you want to have the fashion stuff, you go to this guy. So they know that people are different. So I think we can conclude that most professional photographers are very aware of them having a style, and so are you. I like to think that I have a style, but I'm pretty sure there's a lot of people out there who has never even considered what a style is. And what would your advice be to them as regards to finding their own style?
When we talk about this, I think, of course, there's a way of shooting and seeing. What do you find interesting when you're shooting? But a lot of it, finding your own style is also kind of, when you work with it afterwards in Photoshop, you know what you like and you kind of decide. Like my style, as I told you, is very saturated.
Yeah.
So I take out a lot of colors.
I would call it desaturated then.
Desaturated.
But monochrome-ish.
Yes, but still, there is a little.
Black and white, blue, and, blue and white.
Blue and white,
black,
yeah.
Whatever.
Something like that. Yeah, saturated is the right word.
Desaturated.
Desaturated is the right word. Sorry, my English.
Fair enough.
Okay. No, but I think that a lot of the things, experimenting in Photoshop and being really trying the limits and then going back and finding and seeing what you like. So play with it. For me, all this has been really playing and trying and be inspired and going back and trying things out and seeing what I like and shooting a lot. I shoot a lot. Like people are like, wow, you shoot so much. Like, yes, I do. I shoot a lot of pictures.
Okay.
And then I choose one out of 100 or something
that
has that spark I'm looking for.
Okay.
The thing that makes you want to look at the pictures just more than one time. It's kind of this little, the thing that makes you be like, oh, what is this? I don't understand. You know, you want to go back, you get fascinated.
So, yeah, okay, so taking your style, will you be able to make a living out of having this style?
Well, that's what I hope.
Yeah. but how's your, the business people that you relate to or you sell your stuff to, the magazines. I know that you do, I know you get your stuff published often, different various magazines, commercial stuff. How do people react to it? How do they say, great style? Or do they say, this is underwater photography? Or what do they do? I mean, because these people, you're selling your stuff to people who are not divers. Yeah. You're selling to picture editors who don't know anything about diving.
Yeah. What I hear is that I show pictures another world that they will never ever, maybe never ever see.
Mm.
And for them, this is really a big thing. Yeah. That I can go there and I can take the pictures. Like sometimes underwater is much better than fantasy. Yeah. Sorry, I think I'm
pretty sure you're actually answering the question quite well. But let's continue on the subject. Mm-hmm. So you're trying to make a living out of this. How do you make a living being an underwater photographer? I mean, is there any way? Which way to go? If there's somebody out there saying, I would really like to try and do that. Do you know anyone who's making a living out of being an underwater photographer?
Not really. I don't think so. I'm in contact with a lot of underwater photographers, especially freediving photographers from around the world. I think all of us, or all of those people I know, is kind of doing photography and besides doing fashion or, having another job next to, or it's very few people who connect to make a living because it's a small market and maybe one day it will open up to be more, you can kind of see the possibilities in there.
Yeah. So, but we talked about different ways to actually press on with this subject. If you want to make a living being an underwater photographer, which direction should I go? If I wanted to make a living of doing what I'm doing?
I think that, for instance, underwater fashion is like I see it coming up with a lot of, you have shootings with people, doing some kind of fashion underwater.
Yeah.
I think that's a kind of unexplored area still. Mm. Even there is people working on it. Like video shooting.
Yeah.
I think you can, if you're a really good videographer, I think you can really show people what it's like down there. And taking them traveling.
Yeah.
These amazing things.
Because we see a lot more pictures from or films from underwater, don't we? I mean...
Mm-hmm.
You can hardly see any nature show on TV with water unless there's water pictures on there. I mean, that's partly because due to the GoPro, and it's easy to stick the camera underwater now, or do you even do stuff with it? I mean, so, but actually, maybe that's creating the people who buy the products aware of the world down there are able to pay. So, fashion and video?
I have made money a little bit on selling a reportage from competitions because people are super amazed by people who can go to like 100 meters. Like this is crazy world. How can anybody go to 100 meter with the amount of pressure there is there, and they go in one breath? So there is a lot of fascination. If you're able to sell that fascination, you can sell the reportage for magazines and stuff. So like the competition,
the documentation of actual events.
Yeah. Yeah.
So to say,
yeah.
You're just saying it with a twist and trying to make it even dramatic.
Mm-hmm. You can say that, yeah.
Yeah. Okay, so events, fashion photographer and video, that's it. If you're sitting out there, anything else?
Yeah.
Anything else?
Reportage, I don't know. I think there is many options. Even I know people who is so good underwater photographers, they make a living on it online. Like Instagram, Facebook, just promoting themselves, and in that way, you can promote yourself.
I know a lot of my customers, or customer that's been by my shop occasionally, has been getting into pool photography with kids, taking them underwater with these.
That's true. Yeah. Baby swimming.
And line up a whole group of parents, and they love these pictures. They love these pictures of their small kids. So that should be good money in that, right?
Probably.
So there's a lot of people out there who wants to go to me and buy a lot of houses, right? And now you told them how to make a living so they can come and buy stuff. That's great. Thanks for doing that. Okay, I think that's good luck with trying to make a living on only this, and or at least just using it to clear your head when you've been out.
It's very important in my life. It's like
stuff.
The ocean is really important for me. I can really feel that I change my balance if I'm not in the ocean.
Yeah, it's very interesting. I used to be when I was younger. I say I couldn't think of the office when I was underwater. So I think a lot of people out there can relate to that.
Yeah,
at least. We're all stressful lives. Okay. Mm. Excellent. I made a small mark here saying competitions because you did actually. Did you win a competition with some underwater shots?
Yeah.
I know you just handed in pictures for.
Yeah, it's this time of the year for all the competitions, the World Press, the Danish Picture of the Year, and these different big international competitions. They all kind of have their 2016 deadlines now.
Yeah, because I tried to get you in for doing the webinar yesterday, and she was, you know, you had to give in pictures Sunday night, and you only had 2 months to do that, so it takes a long time to find the right images, right?
Yeah.
There are some, I've had a lot of underwater photography competitions over the years, I've held them on dive shows and stuff, but I can't really decide if I like underwater photography competitions. Or photography competitions because people have such a different view on pictures. I mean, probably out there, the people who say your pictures don't mean much to me, and how would they then judge the picture in a competition? So I have this feeling that I know, even the stuff I've judged over the years, I know that it's just a matter of who's having, you know, the loudest voice. That's the one who gets to choose the winning picture. Sorry to say, but it is. So, but you still attend a lot. Why do you spend so much time joining these competitions?
First of all, I really would like to show what I'm doing. And if you can get into winning a competition, you know, you're having your face out there, or your name out there.
Yeah.
Which is pretty important if you want to make a living on it.
Yeah. That makes sense.
Yes. Also, if you can call yourself a prize-winning photographer. It just looks good. People believe in you. People want success, people. So if you have this kind of stamp on your forehead saying prize winning, it doesn't matter so much, but it's a quality stamp.
Yeah, I can see that. Yeah. So.
And I have this, I'm not sure I'm right, but it does actually, maybe it's not the prize itself that you go for, but it's what comes with being the prize winner. It can actually comes work, it can come assignments, all these things that can come after having won a competition.
Okay, I see why. I understand why. Because it's something that all the magazines back here home, they say that if some of their photographers has won a prize, they say, oh, he or her won the World Press. But they have so many categories. I mean, I think that you gotta
win
something
somewhere. And there's so many photographers.
Yeah. Well,
so right, we all have a camera, and we're all photographers in some way.
Yeah, I think people out there are eager to see some more pictures. So why don't we just run through some?
The pictures that I'm gonna show.
I just need to turn it on here. Okay. And there we go.
This the pictures that I'm gonna show is from the last year I shot with the. Since I got the Nauticam, I really got into it, as I told you. Mm. And just playing around with it, getting to know where all the buttons are and, you know, how to expose with it.
Yeah.
So this is from Egypt, Tehran. Mm. Egypt was selling off an island to Saudi Arabia.
Okay.
And so we knew that this was last time to go there. So we took a boat and got there. And this picture is taken in a... There was a really big current here, so this Alex is his name. He's just floating, and the current is taking him. And I really like to express this feeling of weightlessness, that you just let yourself go and let the ocean take you.
It's nice. It's a nice shot.
Thank you.
Sorry. Oh, I need to get the mouse over here and do this. I think so. Yeah.
Yeah. This is actually one of the first pictures I took with the Nauticam.
Okay.
Yeah. I was doing a photo shoot and I was on the bottom. I was this, it's actually the same freediver. He's going down to me and we had prepared something down that he would come down and swim. And I look up and a lot of the shoots I do, I plan them. But sometimes, you know, something happens that you never planned and you just have to take the picture. And it might not be the picture you planned, but something else comes out that is something you didn't. It was like, oh, should I take this? This was not always in what I expected. So just keep the mind open for whatever comes, because underwater there it's so difficult to control. You cannot communicate.
I hate the fact that you have just one breath and you can just, you say, oh, it's almost there, it's almost there, it's almost, oh, oh, I have to go up.
Yeah. Well, that's why you need to do a lot of training, like yeah. spending a lot of amount in the water.
Yeah.
So then I've done been doing a lot of, like I started my freediving career doing competitions.
Mm-hmm.
I shot the world championship in 2009 in Charm.
Yeah.
And this was, it was really fun. Mm-hmm. I had no idea what I was doing.
Okay.
I actually won the picture of the year sports feature in Denmark for it, which was
oh, yeah.
super amazing. I wasn't even able to dive. So I was kind of going down feet first and struggling. And I decided I wanted to learn it. And since I've been shooting a lot of competition and a lot of training on the line, but sometimes the line can be somehow limiting and you start looking for other options. What is there to show?
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. I can see why. Yeah. Because that's what everybody takes a picture of.
Yeah.
Next one here. Like
yeah.
like an elephant.
Yeah.
You always got to be aware of the elephant.
Exactly. Yeah. The elephant.
Where's this?
It is on the bottom of Red Sea, 26 meters depth. There is an elephant. It is made of trash. There is a lot of pollution, a lot of pollution problems, plastic and all kind of shit in the water
yeah.
coming in. And some artists trying to take...
make aware
of it. Yeah, make
aware
of it. And they built this elephant and put it there.
So out of, it's out, kind of a, out of trash? Or?
Out of trash. I think if you go close, you can see like knives and forks and all kind of
okay,
weird things.
Yeah, yeah.
And what happens is that this turns into a reef. So the fish are there, they live there. I think there was a big lionfish when we shot this somewhere. I don't know if you see it.
Let's see if the resolution is good enough.
No.
I can't see any
that
knives.
It's like, no. Yeah. But there is many, many details on it. And it's pretty amazing that what nature does when we do projects like this, like
yeah.
sinking a boat and then trying to construct a reef on it.
Yeah.
So the coral is growing.
Mm.
We need this.
Same place as the other?
No. This is Indonesia.
Yeah.
We were out looking for manta rays.
Yeah.
And I always been fascinating with the... with the surface from underneath,
yeah.
the structures that comes.
Yeah, me too.
It's incredible. If, for instance, if you see rain underneath,
yeah.
or sometimes I just take pictures of the surface.
Yeah.
It's not anything. It's more like a feeling, some emotion that comes up, an ambience of it.
Yeah.
So this was a really quite rough day, and there was big waves.
It seems rough.
Yeah.
Let me just give a comment to the viewers, because somebody's asking us questions and we haven't been aware of the chat here. So we can do a lot of talks, questions afterwards. But one of them is that we are going to talk about camera solutions just shortly and some other technical training. Do you do any exhibiting of your shots? Somebody asks. Jens asks.
I did before in Egypt, in Cairo. I did an exhibition with underwater portraits.
Thanks. We're really
you're welcome.
It's
not there anymore.
Yeah.
No, not really. It would be lovely.
Well, maybe we should make a FOTOGRAFIT exhibition somewhere,
yeah.
traveling one.
Yeah.
We need a sponsor. Any sponsors out there? Okay. This is a man and a woman, I can see.
Yeah.
Who is it?
This is... it is shot in Tenerife, in Spain. These two are some of the really strong freedivers of the world. They were training together. And she's Alenka Anik, she's Slovenian.
Yeah.
She's a very, very strong diver. And she was there training before the World Championship, Seamus.
Mm.
There is Seamus has a freediving
branch.
Branch, yeah. And she... did after this picture was taken, she went to the Seamus world record, world championship.
Yeah.
And she did a world record to 92 or 3 meters going deep. So I have been super fortunate to meeting these people, hanging out with them. And of course, they're so strong underwater.
Yeah. Yeah.
That it also gives, it's easy for me. I can tell them, you know, you want to do this,
mm-hmm.
and they're going to do it because yeah. They have long times on the water and they are like small fish, mermaids and mermen.
Yeah. Cool. Same girl I can see.
Yes, that is her again.
It's a half and half shot.
Yeah.
That's what it's called, you know?
Yeah.
Just in case you don't know.
Yeah. Yeah, it's fun to play with.
It's really tricky to do half and half shots because the contrast of the light level below water and the brightness of the day
mm-hmm.
Are so high, also so such a big difference.
Mm-hmm.
And so if you get a well lit surface, you rarely get nothing but a dark picture on the water. But with the present cameras we have, you are able to take out the information in the dark areas and dim the bright ones.
Mm.
But normally I say that you always need external light if you want to do half and half shots. But here you didn't. You just used the sun.
Yeah. She's just on the surface and the light is hitting her.
Yeah.
In Photoshop, I have been a little bit on the top. I've underexposed it a little bit in Photoshop. But basically it's like this.
Yeah.
It's a little bit overexposed on her.
Yeah.
But what I really like about this picture is actually all the small stars in the water, snowflakes, or what you call them.
The bubbles. Or
yeah, I don't know what they are.
Air
like
particles.
Particles. Yeah. I really like them because it gives some kind of, I don't know, poetic feeling to it.
You know, most people out there would say, no, we can't use this picture because it's too messy. There's too many particles and backscatter on them.
Mm. Yeah. I have never, I never find it, like, I always kind of trying to find the possible best way to shoot in the conditions I'm in.
Mm.
And sometimes you just get a present from, it can be dusty water, and then you get, like, something that is really hard to see, and suddenly there is an arm coming out, or, you know, so it's more subtle.
Yeah.
Like, everything doesn't have to be explained in a picture. Sometimes what's interesting is that it's not explained.
Okay, yeah. Sorry, that's just a technical issue again. From are we clear so far? Do I need to be more careful about changing the pictures?
No, it's fine.
Okay. Oh, you should just complain. You should complain to Sophus. He's the technical guy behind this. Okay, let's see if you got any more pictures here.
Mm-hmm.
Nope, not in this round.
Okay.
So we covered, let me just see if I can. There we are.
Hello.
Full screen. Hello again.
Hello, yeah.
Hello again. thanks for showing. Hey. Are we good?
Video's missing.
So when you change between viewing a picture and switching back to live camera of your faces, it takes a while, apparently. Okay, thank you for telling me, Matthias. Turn web camera off, turn microphone off, turn screenshot on. Are we good? Hi. Talk to me.
Wait for it. We're stand by.
And stand by. We got a lift off. Okay. Can everybody still hear me out there? Okay. Still no video? No video? It's not. Oh, video, so you mean the camera, right?
Yes.
Let me turn it off and back on.
Yes.
Did it work?
Yes.
All right.
Good.
Hello.
Again.
Excellent. Loud and clear. And video is apparently back. Good. Excellent. We've been covering the competitions now, and it's soon. I think we should. Because time is really running, and I promised it was just going to last 45 minutes, this one. I was a little late, but we're a little overdue. Let's talk about cameras, equipment. Before we do that, what camera? What was your first camera? I'm curious.
My first camera?
Yeah.
It was Eva Marine bag, plastic bag.
Oh,
yeah. Putting it in, and then I shot a whole reportage for a newspaper on it.
Yeah, with what was in it? What camera was in it?
It was, I would think it was a 5D, 5D Mark II,
or 5D, two at the time, probably.
Yeah, probably, yeah. And it was so difficult.
Oh,
it was, but I shot it diving, like scuba diving, and then I realized I need to learn this and I need better equipment.
Okay, and then you got what?
Then I got a used CNC camera with the Nikon 200.
D200?
Yeah.
Yeah.
With a Sigma.
That's a few 10. Years back.
It is. Yeah. But I loved it.
And it was used still.
It was used. Used. Yeah, well, yeah. But okay. For me, it was like, wow, I have my own. It was incredible.
Yeah.
With the Sigma, you know, one of the fours, Nikon.
The Sigma?
Yeah, the Sigma, yeah.
Sigma's improved a little bit today. Sigma, I remember Sigma from the old days. That was not a buzzword. Sigma today is pretty different. They are some of the best in lens styling today.
Okay.
And particularly the Art series are amazing for full frames. I want to get one of them.
Yeah, but I was really happy with it and it was cheap. So, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And
then I had an Acolyte for very short time.
Yeah.
And it was
with camera in it?
Because I'm so much on the road.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, with the camera it was a 7D Canon.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. But I was so much on the road and it's so big and it's so bulky.
Did you get that from you then?
No, that was also used.
All right.
and so I sold it again because I was not really happy with it. It was like I had this back flash. I think you can better explain it than I can. Like when the light comes into the lens, when in backlight.
When the dome dome is not properly coated, the lens flare is gonna mess up the light particles inside the dome, and it's gonna give false light back into the lens.
Yeah, and it reflects on the.
Particularly if you're at the surface where you have a lot of light, sun hitting, you would be in a bad state.
Mm. Yeah, and it reflects. And it ruined so many of my files. So I was like, you know.
The good thing is you can see what it says on the lens, because you can normally, if you have a bad coating on a lens, you can see it says Olympus or...
Wow, I would love that on all my shots.
Yeah. Yeah.
No, and then I bought my first new camera.
Yeah.
And which was, I'll just take it.
Yeah.
Because here's my baby.
Oh, no. Mm.
Yeah. Yeah.
Tell me about it. Or tell us about it.
Because I'm working so much in places, because I'm working so much, I'm traveling a lot. I don't know if you want.
I just want to take this one off because it's making noises.
Thank you. I'm working so much in areas of the world where people are really poor and I'm traveling a lot. I'm basically living in my backpack. I wanted a camera that was light.
Yeah.
I didn't want to carry around with it, like a big one. And then I knew that if I found a
Took the camera
one,
out maybe.
Yeah, so.
So you travel the world with a small camera like this one.
Yeah. Also because if you travel in Africa where people have nothing and you arrive and having this massive camera, I really don't like that. I like it. I like it to be as simple camera as possible.
Hmm.
I don't want to come into a small village in Africa and you have this kind of. You know, I'm a white woman and
lots of money,
and then I have this massive camera. So I really tried to get something that was kind of look basic.
Yeah.
I
do
and
remember.
Then
yeah,
I found the Fuji.
Mm.
They're working a lot with their small cameras,
mm.
and you sold me this one.
I did. I do remember that. Yeah.
Yeah, and this one is still this one.
I remember we talked a lot about the dome, and you were a little bit angry with me, weren't you?
Yeah.
Yeah. You were.
I was.
You gotta come into the picture, I think.
Oh.
Come on over here. Yeah. There we go. Yeah. There we are.
I was really hoping to get something that was super light.
Yeah.
And then you talked me into get this dome because I was having so many problems with the dome we had before. You can take this off.
It's a glass dome. It's an 18 centimeter glass dome. And I knew that she needed to not have too much distortion on her lens. So she needed a glass dome that was a bit of a size. You wanted a really small mini dome.
Yeah.
Yeah, it wasn't going to work for you. And no. I remember actually when you got it, you sent me, I remember you were not too pleased when you got it because I sent this one
you
to said Egypt.
Yes, because I was in Egypt.
Yeah, you lived there. In Egypt at the time, yeah. So, yeah, well.
But now it just really makes sense to me to have this lens. Like I have no, it's just really, really easy to work with.
Mm.
It's nice to have be within the water. I always have the camera as an extended arm of myself when I free dive, and it's there and I trust it. And especially also with the valve that sucks
the
out.
Valve,
the
yeah.
valve,
yeah.
valve.
The vacuum, vacuum valve?
Valve, that sucks the out
valve.
Here. Valve.
The vacuum valve.
The vacuum valve.
Sucks air out of the housing and makes it tight. Watertight.
So when I'm in the water, when I'm in the water and I can really, I can trust it. There is a green light flashing.
Yeah.
And if it's not flashing or if it's a red color, you know, I can get out of the water.
Yeah.
And it's just a big, good security for me.
What you don't know is that just when Nanna got in here this afternoon, we had to change the class for her because she made a scratch in it.
Accidentally, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, I'm rough with my equipment.
Yeah, and you're a traveler and you're a freediver, and I haven't seen that big and deep a glass cup before.
Really? So I impressed you?
Yeah, you impressed Christopher at least, right, Christopher?
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. But he changed it.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that anyway, I'm happy that you're pleased with the system. And I think the problem when you're a freediver is that you're at the surface all the time, so you don't have the pressure of the housing. I mean, when we go diving, we can go down looking at our equipment, and then once we are just a couple of meters down, the pressure of the O-rings is high enough to keep it sealed. But when you're freediver, you go up and down all the time, and you stress the lenses, you stress the handle and the housing. Mm. And so because you don't have the constant pressure of the O-rings, and if you're in the surface, you're in a very high risk of flooding your equipment. So if you're a freediver, I would say a vacuum system is a must.
And I'm super, super grateful for it.
Because you can relax when the light is green. Several housings have this, but so I would say you should have this.
Since it's available.
Yeah.
You know, it's just.
I know you had a housing for your iPhone as well, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and I saw some images of that.
Yeah.
I'm taking my iPhone down diving occasionally in my small housing, and I have a wide angle for it, and I really enjoy that. I just sold the system to a guy that maybe he's even watching tonight. He was used to be an old photographer, underwater photographer, and he was getting back into it, and they bought this iPhone housing, and he was just like, wow, the screen is so big. And the last camera he had was a film camera, so now he could actually see the... I really like the...
I have had a lot of... Or some people is writing me and asking me about my equipment or how should I buy. And like, if you're just going to go on holiday with your kid and shoot some video and you're not going to go deep, you know, the iPhone in a casing, if you dare... Because you know, it's quite expensive. If something happens,
about floodings.
No, happened neither have I. But it's super fun to play with. It's easy.
It and the good thing is that you can get your pictures up on Facebook almost instantly, and you can edit films and pictures in the apps that goes with it. So it's so easy. Excellent. So that's partly equipment. How about lights? You're not getting into the light area.
No. I
for your macro photography. Are you gonna get a flat port at some point? What's your plans?
I would not even know what that is. But
flat port.
If I need it, you know, you'll tell me.
Okay.
Yeah.
You have the dome port, and that doesn't magnify the image in the water.
Mm-hmm.
So when you do a macro, if you want to get closer, you don't want that magnification you want the magnification the same as your mask. So you have a flat port so that the image magnifies, and then you want to get really close to the stuff. And all macro lenses look at images like this, and wide angles look at images like this. So even if you can get close like you were, you would still have a completely different image, but the macro image. And most macro lenses don't have any high depth of field.
Okay.
So one of the main things with macro pictures is that you don't have any. It's very easy to put the fish are nudibranch in focus and the background's going to be blurry, whereas on your wide angle the background's going to be completely sharp and clear, just as the front. So you need to compose a lot better. You can do wide angle close-up pictures. It was very popular a couple of years ago. And then you can get up front and close with a nudibranch with your wide angle, but you need to be aware that you have a background. It makes it a lot harder, so your composition has to be completely different.
Oh, challenging.
So yeah. I would be happy if you started doing that.
Yeah.
But it's fun with macro.
No, but back to your question.
What was my question?
You talk about lighting.
Yeah.
I always shoot with the light that there is, because it's... for me, it's super challenging. It's super fun to, you know, constantly using your eyes. Mm-hmm. And that is in itself a challenge. So you always look how the light, when I do a diving competition and I have to shoot, I always kind of, before I dive, I situate myself around to see where would the light hit the diver? What would I want? Would I want to have the backlight, or do I want the diver to have light on it? From what side? And it's always something I use very much.
Sorry that I'm just focusing over here, because what you're saying is that's 1 hour has been up now, and I promised it wasn't going to be this long, but it is. What you just said is how you move in the water, and some people have already asked us about... sorry, a lot of questions came out. I just need to focus on what I'm trying to say here. You work a lot with people in the water. And that's something I really enjoy, when people are aware of what they're taking pictures of. Most pictures I see with dive buddies and other divers in them that people take are taken with divers turning away, because the photographer often forgets to make an agreement with your buddy underwater or at surface before they go down. So actually doing buddy communication is very important. But you only have one breath. So how do you work with your models? How do you make sure you get the composition, and how do you make sure that the sunburst and the light that hits them, or the silhouettes, how do you make sure that all these things get up into a higher
I use my eyes so much, you know. I'm constantly, you know, thinking, and then if I am with the people doing a photo shoot, you know, I can arrange. We go up and I say, I would like if you do like this and that. And of course, you cannot shout at people being like, you know, doing something. So you plan something on the surface, and then you go down. And from there you play and you see what comes out of it.
Do you see?
No, because most of the time...
You're in surface.
Yeah, you don't communicate in that sense. Because I don't really want people to look at me when they're... when I take
you want them to move, maybe.
Yeah, I like movement. I like light. I like structures, particles in the water, light flashing into the, or coming in through the surfing, and make these lines and
sunburst. This one. Let's see. If
and so there's
some
situations, which one of these here, where you can. I don't know if you're showing them actually. Are you?
I'm not.
No.
I'm just showing them for you.
Yeah, excellent.
Yeah, because so just nice. In case you don't know them. Thank you, Sofus. Talking about for the last half an hour.
But for when a picture like this you can control, because you know people are going to be close to the line.
Oh yeah,
and this is what you want. Okay, you're going to be there.
The line pictures.
Yeah,
that's
the line pictures. I like them, but sometimes you
I get your
get
point about trying to get away from. I think it's a face. If you need to do freediving pictures, you need to
the
get
thing
your
is that you when you do stuff like this, you have to keep being fascinated. Because it's like, okay, people go down, people come up, people surface, people swim in other ways, but it's always on the line.
And they come up, and they come down. Yeah, I get it. Yeah.
And then you really have to kind of keep your eyes open for something new. It might be a hand, it might be a way the hand. Look at his hand here. It's like, you know, it's so relaxed. And he's, you know, for me, like the small signs, it might be, you know.
Do you use, as a question here, do you use manual settings when you shoot pictures?
No, I do sometimes. Depends. It depends on the what shape I'm in physically.
Yeah.
if I'm fit in free diving, which takes a lot of training, you know, I have more time on the water.
Yeah.
But sometimes when I start out, I put it on aperture. How do you say when you
fix it on aperture?
Fixed aperture.
Yeah.
And then I let the
shutter speed
and then I underexpose a little bit.
I do.
Yeah, I expose one stop.
Because of the...
Because of the backlight.
Yeah, the strong sunlight beams coming down. Yeah, I get your point. So that's a good... and obviously you're shooting in RAW, right?
Yeah.
Yes.
All the time in RAW.
All the time. You don't have to do any settings when you're doing RAW, right?
No. It's so nice.
Then it's nice with RAW. If anybody out there taking pictures who don't do RAW and have a camera that can do RAW, shame on you.
Just start. It's such a playground when you use that.
Yeah. Okay. Can you use the touchscreen when you use the UV housing for the phone? I think I can answer that. You download an app for the phone housing. So there's four different buttons, and you can the four different places you touch the screen has different functionalities. This is how most of the systems work. There's a new housing that has come out from the guy that originally built Aquatica. He made one with a swiping knob in it so that you can actually use the touchscreen as being a touchscreen. It's nice, a little bit more expensive. What is the camera? Let's take that one. It's a Fuji...
It's a Fuji X-T1.
Yep.
With a lens...
1020?
24, but it's not full frame, so it's like 16:35.
Yeah.
Because sometimes I'm not really a super fan of super wide angled.
No.
For me, it's getting an effect, and it's nice first time, and the second time it's super nice, and then third time it's like, okay, now I've seen it.
Yeah.
And so I try to kind of keep close to what the eyes actually might see, so it doesn't get.
Matthias from Sweden has a question for you. He says, I guess you're ditching, when you're ditching the video light, and the flashes, not wanting them. That's because you want your images to be desaturated anyway. Extra lights will give you too much color for your own preferences. Is that correct?
Yeah.
No, you should have said no.
No?
No, he would have been confused. you're right. I think
extra light will give you too much colors for your own preference.
What he means is when you have direct light from a flash, that's when you get the colors.
Yeah, exactly.
Diffused light from light that's been diffused through the water or it's been diffused by diffusers on your flash will not give you as powerful colors as if you're hitting anything with direct light. And I think what it means is that because of your style, you want the desaturated overall, like the almost monochrome things. Mm. If you remember the macro shot you had with the taken with the torch, it was also monochrome, except for the nudie prank frogfish, who was then colorful, right?
Yeah,
because you hit it with a very
with
direct
light. Yeah.
So that was very colorful.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's the effect of direct light. Okay, so yes, Matthias, you're right. okay, any more pictures here? I was just curious about how you handle all these models. See, this one I saved for last because it's one of my favorites. Did you steal that image or that idea out from someone? You stole it, didn't you? You didn't invent that yourself.
Probably not. No, actually, it was his idea, the guy in the picture.
Ah, there you go.
So,
no, I really like it. It's very creative and it's... It just confused me when I saw it first.
Yeah, it's nice, isn't it?
Yeah.
This is what I talk about when you see a picture and you keep going back to it because you don't understand it. So it's kind of, it has this little bit of like, what is going on?
Yeah.
And this is what, for me, it's like, wow, you were looking at it for some time, which is like a big compliment for me.
Yeah.
No, but we were diving together in Indonesia and then this light comes down underneath the boat we were diving from.
Yeah.
And he was like, oh, if I do this and that and then...
Let's see if we have problems again coming back online. What do you say, Sofa? Are we back?
You're online?
We're online? Okay, here. Don't know why we have this little resistance in getting the video's picture back. Anyway, we're very close to getting through. I wrote something called insurance. Is your housing insured?
Yes.
Did you use
Luckily.
It?
Luckily.
Lars, I have a scratch. Do you have an insurance? Actually, in Denmark, it's not very common to have an insurance.
Mm-hmm.
In Norway, it's very common to have an insurance. Everybody has an insurance. I think Sweden too, but in Denmark, it's just nobody really does it.
Yeah.
I've been trying to find the right insurance for people who ask me, but and there are insurances out there, but you're insured.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, I cannot imagine not being insured when I have so expensive equipment. Yeah. For me, this is a big investment.
Yeah.
And if I ruin it, I just don't have another, I don't know how much money.
So you don't have double? You don't have backup?
Yeah, the iPhone.
Right, yeah. The other thing is, how do you get through the airport? If you travel all the time with, you know, with your, obviously your, I wanted actually to find, you made a video file. Let's see if I have it here. Could be here. I think maybe we can actually, yeah. I think we are able to run it like this.
This is, it's a little bit something I did.
Time, yeah. You ready, guys?
Yeah.
This is your equipment, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. See, I like that you're traveling with this. How do you get the cat into the bag?
It goes itself.
Yeah. This was very fast. Let's run it again, just to make absolutely sure you saw the cat. Do you see the mouse as well coming in? So that's what you have: a wetsuit and a bikini. That's how you travel.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Basically.
Okay.
This
that's how you get through the airport. Then I can imagine. Okay.
Yeah. Well, sometimes I look really funny because the long lens I always have in my hand.
The
long fins.
The fins. Okay.
Yeah. Sorry. Yeah. That I always have in my hand, and then I take the dome.
Yeah.
In my hand as well, and I pack up the housing of.
Yeah. And when they start asking you, what do you tell them?
Well, actually.
Pause. Pause. Sound. Okay. Hope you're ready. You all there? We're back. Okay. Yeah. So you do get through the customs, airport security quite well.
Sometimes they ask, but most of the time they ask because they are curious.
Video missing.
Okay.
Okay.
For me, it has never caused me any problems.
Hmm.
Yes.
So, okay. But you know, people ask, "What is this?"
It's not because you're Scandinavian and blonde. That's not why.
I don't know. No, I never tried to be anything else, so.
I'm Scandinavian, not that blonde.
Okay, come on.
I'm more blonde now than I was before. Hmm. Let's see if I have more pictures here. I have, you know, we're getting very close to the end of this webinar and the question and the freebie that I want to give. I just have a few pictures. I saw one of your pictures and I decided to ask you about this. I think that's really important. Let's take both of them and let me see how you feel when I show you. No, I know we can't see it because I haven't turned this one on yet. There we go. What is on this image?
It is one day we were diving in Blue Hole. In Egypt, the training, and then suddenly this huge amount of jellyfish mixed up with a huge amount of plastic comes in, and it's just all over. And I think, first of all, this is our plastic. It comes from all over the world.
Yeah.
It's really disgusting, and it's kind of, for me, having been in so much in the ocean, the health of the ocean has really got into my heart, which is why I shoot pictures like this, because it's important to tell, to see what is there, why are the marine animals dying from our plastic debris in the water. Like, we all have a really big responsibility in this matter. First of all, we have to collect.
You're out there, you can take pictures of this. Do you try to sell them? Do you try to get awareness of this? I mean, everybody knows these days, don't they? But they don't really know it. They don't really believe it.
Why? The thing is that people don't want to see it. Yeah. I can see it on my Instagram as well.
Yeah.
If I post a picture like this one, I don't get, you know, people are like, whatever, let's look the other way. And if I post a picture of a nice guy underwater, I get super many likes. I think it's really tough business to get into, because this is looking at ourselves.
Yeah.
And And there is so many people working on how to solve this issue with our plastic. And these are really things that we should support, buying things that is dissolving themselves into water and kind of made of roots or made of something. Yeah. Because this is never going away. We throw like 88 tons of plastic into the ocean every year. We do.
8 ton, I think, is one.
Probably more than that. Yeah. And
per person, maybe.
Yeah, and actually the plastic that we use, 50% of the plastic that we use it once.
Yeah.
And then we throw it away, and it ends up there.
Okay, I'm pretty sure everybody agrees that this was the sad part, and we should all agree to actually do something about it. I have some friends up in Greenland. When we used, Steve and I went up and did some projects up there, and they did. One of the guys, he told me that his, I think it was his daughter who went and used a university down in Denmark, and she went back home to do some studies of the amount of plastic stuff within the cod and how much plastic was in. And there was just so much plastic within the food chain that it was way, way below, above the levels that is healthy.
Yeah.
And I mean, the Greenlanders, they haven't probably filled the ocean with much plastic. It comes from somewhere else, so.
Well, really, I think we all have a responsibility. Yeah. You know, you buy something that is full of plastic, and then you put it in a plastic bag instead of bringing a plastic bag. You know, there's so many small things that you can use, and just be as a consumer, you can make a choice.
Yeah.
Try at least.
Why do I look so big? You have to sit up. I'm not that.
I go closer.
Yeah, that's good. Okay. Anyway, we are, as I said before, very close to the end of the webinar. Mm-hmm. There's a question here. I think maybe this is about time that you hit us with your questions. And please ask Nanna a lot of questions if you have them. You're more than welcome to ask me anything. I only know the technical parts. But hit us with a question. There's one here. Do you put the UV housing in the baggage when you're traveling on an airplane? Where do you store it? So where's the rest of the housing goes? Your luggage, or?
I don't know if I should be, you know, I'm a little bit embarrassed. I put it in my wetsuit. I wrap it around my wetsuit, mm-hmm. and then I wrap my clothes around that, and I put it in my suitcase, which is like a hard suitcase.
Mm-hmm.
And that's it, and I hope for the best.
I do the same thing.
Okay.
Yeah,
excellent.
I take it apart because it won't fit in the hand luggage anyway.
Yeah, but the dome I always keep with me.
Okay.
Yeah, it goes
good
with
me. one thing I've been really looking forward to is to say thank you to you guys for joining the webinar and attending for this long. And because of that, and Nanna was willing to give one of her pictures away for your background screen on your computer, so that when you sit every day and work hard, sweaty in the office, you can watch Nanna's pictures and think that it was you who should have been out there with your underwater housing doing underwater shots instead of sitting in that dusty office I do. So I want to show you this image, and I would be pleased if you just give me... Let me know what you think out there about when you see an image like this.
This is interesting. It's always interesting because I don't know how people react to my work.
No.
No.
It's called, I call it the sky, the cloud. I think I call it the cloud.
Mm-hmm.
I call it
the moment.
The moment. Oh,
the ocean has said goodbye and the sunset is saying goodnight.
Yeah.
Or the sky is saying goodnight. Yeah. Oh. It's a long title. I can't exactly remember.
I didn't know you titled it, but
yeah.
So this picture, I don't know if you like it or not, but we're going to send you a screen resolution out. For you guys out there, if you don't have any more questions for me and for Nanna, we're going to send you this image later. And I think we're going to rerun, we're going to send a link out to this webinar so you can see it again, or if maybe some of you didn't, are not present, so who am I talking to? Anyway, I'm happy that you stayed for this long, and if you have interesting people that you think I should invite in here for doing webinars, please let me know. And I hope that you all know you're very welcome to send me emails with not only technical stuff, but maybe you need to know your own style and you need somebody to tell you your style. I can call Nanna then.
You know, I'm struggling enough in my own style, so I'm not sure I can tell anybody else their style.
Actually, one of my friends who became national champion of underwater photography a couple of years back, he did some part shots that was taken within a wave, within the almost on the where the wave breaks, very close to the shore.
Yeah.
And it was just so beautiful. People started talking about whether they were actually dive pictures. And I agree. Are they dive pictures? What do you think? Is that a dive picture? Just because it's taken with an underwater?
I don't know. For me, it doesn't matter if it's a dive picture or a normal picture. I don't need to categorize in that sense.
Oh, you're so true. See, that should be... Listen, everybody out there, that should be your lesson for tonight. It doesn't really matter because it's what happens in your head and in your stomach when you see an image. And sometimes don't limit yourself to thinking that you have an idea of what your image should look like. If it moves something or it showed someone else, if it moves someone else, then I think it's okay, right? So anyway, Nanna, thanks for coming in.
Thank you so much for having me. It's been super nice to talk about my work.
Yeah.
Thank you for being this. Here. You're here?
Let's see. And we're going to wave. Are you, we're online again?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, okay.
Bye-bye out there.
Thank you so much.
Thanks for hanging in there.
Yeah.
And 1 month, I have a new name for you. So stay tuned and watch the Facebook group, okay? Take care out there. End event. Right.